Well, hello everyone. This is Laurie Smith, and I'm glad to be here tonight. I'm just doing a special broadcast here, and this is for a person who's kind of reached out to me and just asking if I can kind of sort of go over what I know of to be sort of that's helped me out along my path and my journey, healing from abuse, from child abuse, from all kinds of issues due to the, you know, adult survivor issues. And everybody's different. Nobody's been through exactly the same things. We've all experienced different things in our lives that may have caused us pain and caused us a lot of difficulties. And even our own, you know, sort of, you know, traumatic events sort of things that we might have done ourselves, you know, that like self-injury or, instead of self-injury, it could be something like self-sabotage type stuff, right? And so, you know, life can be difficult. We can get ourselves into messes. Sometimes it's just a matter of the fact that people are struggling and people are hurting out there. And people, you know, sometimes find it very difficult to deal with these things. I've been dealing with this for my whole life, really, growing up the way that I did. And so I've done a lot of looking in and looking at the situation, especially from the years, really starting around 2007. And tonight, I'm a Christian, born again Christian. I was born again May 22nd, 2007. And before that, I was really struggling and having a very difficult time dealing with my past. And I seemed to be able to hold it together. I was a person that could keep a job, you know, I could keep several jobs at one time. And I was responsible in that manner. And, you know, I'd pay my bills and I wasn't, you know, out hurting anybody or trying to hurt myself so much. As an adult, as a young person, I had a lot of problems, a lot of difficulties with a lot of different things. But I never gave my life to the Lord until May 22nd, 2007, even though I grew up in a Christian home. My problem was that my dad was a Christian. My parents were Christian. My dad was one of my abusers, and so was my mom. And I really didn't want anything to do with Christianity or God. I was very angry at God for allowing these things to happen to my family, for allowing the abuse to happen to me and allowing the abuse to happen in my family and the destruction of my family. So I blamed God instead of blaming the people that it really should have been blamed, which was the two people involved that caused the abuse in the first place. And then my siblings who were traumatized and you know, sort of contributed to the mess that was already going on. So I had a lot of several issues going on. But I was always the type that could hold a job down, go to work, smile. Nobody knew what was going on in my mind. Nobody knew what was going on in my heart. Very few people. I wouldn't tell very many people about the way that I grew up or my life, you know, growing up abused. And just a few people that were really, really close to me. And never really dealt with the issues. I never dealt with the reasons why I did what I did, the reasons why I chose to make decisions that I did as an adult or a young adult. The self-sabotage that I was continuing to do, like quitting jobs if I felt that, you know, I just was, I don't know, any number of things could come up, a confrontation with the boss or anything like that. I really didn't handle confrontation well. I had no self-esteem. I had no self-worth. And I was searching for someone to love me, searching for someone to care about me. And so in my own family, I didn't have that. And so, I'd have a few friends here and there that I would latch on to and, you know, seek that comfort from them, seek that self-acceptance type thing, you know, or that acceptance type thing to, you know, with trying to sort of reach out to people to see if, you know, if I could find somebody who would accept me for me, somebody who would love me just for me, somebody who would be good to me and be kind to me. Well, in life, we know there's bumps, there's problems, there's people are people. And, you know, people do hurt people. It's a terrible thing. So this is kind of what I'm going to speak to you here tonight and just taking a look at this stuff. And I'm not a counselor, you know, I'm not a certified counselor of any sort. I'm a student of God's word, really, is what I am. I study God's word always. I have an associate's in biblical studies and working on a bachelor of ministry and just a continuation of that, really. I haven't finished my bachelor degree yet, but I'm working on it. I've got about a year to go and maybe even longer than that, depending on how much time I can put in on it. And I just love God's word. Well, when I was born again, May 22nd, 2007, that's what happened. And I've been in the Word ever since. But I'm not a counselor. I can't offer any counseling advice. I can't offer any advice, really, period. What I'm going to do is speak to situations sort of based on what I know to be true about certain things for myself. And if it's helpful for you, then it is. If it's not, then disregard it. You know, everybody's, like I said, everybody's different. Everybody needs different things. I would never say to never go to a counselor or never trust that sort of thing. I know for myself, I had problems with and issues with trying with even the thought of going to a counselor or a therapist of any type. And so, you know, for me, I went a different route, and I just ran to God. I finally stopped running from God and actually ran to Him. And I'm really glad that I made that decision. But, you know, so many times, like, that's you know, people need more than that, and they do need, you know, a therapist involved or a counselor, or, you know, to be on medication, that's fine. You know, whatever it is, that whatever it takes to keep you well, whatever it takes to keep you healthy and somewhat, you know, stabilized in your life, that's what you need to do. I'm not a counselor, so I can't speak for you or try to offer advice. All I'm going to do is sort of run through a few things and show you sort of what happened in my life dealing with these issues of, like, self-hatred, self-worthlessness, lack of love for life, really, or love for myself, really, which then made it hard to allow love to come into my life from other people. And just a lot of hatred. My problem was I had a lot of hatred in my heart, which really doesn't leave much room for anything good. And so that's what I'm going to speak to tonight. So, yeah, just listen at your own discretion. And, you know, it's not a counseling session. I'm not a counselor. And I'm just a private person, really, who has been speaking out for years now about the issues adult survivors of child abuse go through. And so I'm just speaking on my story, talking about my life and my family's situation. I'm the last of seven siblings, and just the destruction of my family due to the abuse and the dysfunction. I talk about it publicly because it really helped me out to take a look at it third party, as if, you know, I'm looking in on the situation and take myself out of the emotional part of it and look at it as a third party person and see what happened and actually make some sense of what was going on and what happened to me and to my siblings and to my parents as well. And so that's why I did what I did. But hopefully as survivors of abuse, we get something out of it. But I hope everybody would get something out of it. But I am a Christian, and so tonight I am going to be talking about the Bible. I usually don't mix my Christianity or my Christian beliefs with, or my biblical beliefs with, my adult survivor material, because so many survivors of abuse are very angry, have very, very huge issues with God and huge issues with the whole thing. So I usually don't mix them, but tonight I am going to do a show here talking about what happened to me and where I've come from to get through where I am today, which is really 100, you know, it's like if you could just say on a scale of 1 to 100, you know, 1 being the very lowest pits of hell in my life, to 100 being the very best place I've ever been. I mean, I'm at 100%, you know. God has brought me through the fire, really, and brought me through without the smell of smoke. I mean, it's just, God is so good. And I just recognize that because I pay attention to it, and I'm always in tune with what God's doing in my life. And so I'm very thankful to be on this end of it, let me tell you. But I just was sort of, I just want to speak to a certain few issues here. And I guess I'll start with really with the issue of self-worth, right? And I'll start there. And as far as self-worth goes, you know, biblically, we know, I mean, if a person's a Christian, you read the Bible, and you study the Bible, we know that man fell, and that's Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And because of that, you know, the sin nature came in, then now man has a problem. We've got a real problem. We've got a sin nature. Everything was warped. Everything was twisted when man fell, because we were made in God's image originally, and Adam and Eve made in God's image, right? Yeah, so all of their offspring was to be made in their image from there. But we were to be, you know, very much blessed with the presence of God walking with us, if man wouldn't have fell, let's just say hypothetically, you know, we would be in that original state that God had planned for us the whole time. And we wouldn't have the issues going on this earth that we have going on right now. We wouldn't have any of this stuff going on that's going on right now. But see, God is being omniscient, knows all things, knew that this is what was going to happen because he saw the end from the beginning. And so he knew, so he had a plan. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And the plan, praise God. He had it all planned out. And it is for his glory, praise God. And but it's also to bring us back into right standing with him so that we can, again, once again, walk with him now as his spirit indwells us if we're born again. And then also in eternity, to spend eternity with the Lord. Hallelujah. We'll be back in right standing with him. And we'll be back as it was back in the Garden of Eden before Adam and Eve sinned. And they were in communion with the Lord. He would walk with them in the cool of the day. I mean, praise God. I mean, that's awesome. So we know we've got a big problem. Look around at the world, you know. I mean, there's still some good stuff going on in the world, but it's not nearly what it would have been. You know, even the best, greatest accomplishments man can do, even as far as love, kindness, you know, mercy, compassion, goodness, and all that stuff that really, really counts and really matters. Looking out for each other, taking care of each other. When you see that going on, it's not the norm. It's like people are, it's like a shock. It's like, wow, that person's really nice, or wow, that was really nice of that person to do that, because we're so used to the other, which is people taking advantage, people being hateful, people being hurtful, people being rude, people just not caring, people showing you the worst side that they have generally in any given situation. I work in the public sector, so I work with a lot of work, and I talk to a lot of people every single day, and I see the worst of people and sometimes the best of people. And so this is life. Right? We're all in a fallen world with a sin nature. And so as far as self-worth goes, you know, I mean, what we're worth to God is a lot. He sent his son to die on the cross for all who would believe and come to him for salvation. Praise God. Hallelujah. So he obviously loves us. And the thing is we can't even begin to see ourselves properly as I think we should, because our minds are corrupt, because we have that sin that's, you know, we're still in a fallen world. We're living in a flesh body with a flesh mind, right? And the flesh is still a problem for people. And it will be until we're completely changed from glory to glory, you know, and receive our new creation, resurrection body, you know, and the body that we're going to have for eternity, praise God. And we're going to have the mind of Christ. Well, the Apostle Paul talked a lot about that. He's like, put on the mind, put on Christ. You know, we are to try every day to, you know, we have the mind of Christ. It's just that our minds are, you know, we're still, like I said, we're still in this fallen state, so we can't really quite grasp it. But the issue is as far as worth goes to God, we're worth a lot, because there's no way that he would have the second person of the Trinity, God the Son, come down and be born in Virgin Mary by the Holy Spirit, to be born as a man, a God-man, to take our place on the cross that we deserve to be, and to take our place in order to bring us back into right standing. And so we obviously we matter to God, every single one of us. And so that was a big thing for me when I became a Christian, because I grew up in a home full of abuse and dysfunction, hatred. Hatred was just the norm. My parents were very hateful towards each other. They were hateful towards their children, which caused us to be hateful towards them and towards each other. So none of the siblings really stuck together. Out of seven siblings, we were all kind of enemies in the home, because we were all trying to get each other in trouble so that one would get abused and we wouldn't. You know, it'd be like, okay, what can I do to keep, you know, to keep the abuse coming to me? I'll just point fingers at somebody else, right? So we were all very much enemies, and my parents were enemies, and my parents were enemies to us. So it was like living in a battle zone. It was horrible. And I never received any love or care. I did receive food. You know, I was not starved or anything, or chained up in the basement. The social workers were brought in. I mean, my parents were busted on child abuse charges and had to go to court. And almost lost us, but my mom begged the courts, and they said, okay, well, if you, you know, if your parents go and get counseling, then if you get counseling and you get family counseling and marital counseling and all this stuff, then your children can stay in the home. But if you don't meet these requirements, then they can't. Well, my parents went to like 2 or 3 sessions and that's it. But they left us in the home anyway. So, with supervised visits from the social workers. So, the abuse after the social worker signed off just continued on. It just continued on and on and on and on. And it never did stop. And so my parents just were not able to cope. They were both, they had mental issues. My mom was bipolar. They used to call it manic depression, but then they changed it to bipolar. My mom was bipolar, never got any help, was not on medication. My dad was schizophrenic as well as borderline personality disorder as well as bipolar. And my brother, one of my brothers was bipolar as well. And as far as the diagnosis goes for the family, that's who was diagnosed. So there was a lot of real problems at home. My parents wouldn't get help. They just wanted to be in this rage all the time, in this hatred. And it was just unfortunate. So I didn't grow up with any self-worth. And I didn't even really, you know, I mean, God was just not in the picture. My dad was a Christian, but he would come home and abuse the family after church. And so my mom wouldn't let us go to church with him. And so we'd all stay home with my mom on Sundays. And it was great because my dad wasn't there. There wasn't any fighting going on. As long as we stayed out of our mom's way, we wouldn't be abused. But my dad would then come home from church and then the fight would start. And, you know, it would just trickle down to the children. And this is Sundays, every Sunday in our home. And so, you know, God, I just didn't really have much to do with him. I did know who Jesus was, and I used to see Jesus on the cross at my friend's Catholic church that I used to go with her as I was growing up. And I loved Jesus. I always loved Jesus. I knew who he was. And I was like, no, I used to cry. I just sit there and cry because I so loved him. And I knew he suffered so much, and my family had suffered so much. I really felt a close connection to him in a way because I had seen so much suffering in my family that I kind of equated it to what, you know, to what poor Jesus had suffered on the cross. I was like 7 years old trying to figure this out in my mind, right? But I didn't really quite understand, obviously, the whole thing because I didn't realize what he had gone to the cross for until I got older. And then I didn't want anything to do with it because my dad was a Christian, like I said, and he was abusive and very physically abusive, you know, psychologically abusive towards all of us, and my mom was too. And I was sexually abused by my brother, who was 12 years older than me. I was 8 years old, he was 21, and he raped me for a period of about a year and sexually abused me. So I really couldn't believe that God would just leave me in this mess, and why would he allow these horrible things to happen to me? And I had no self-worth. I didn't care about myself. I didn't care. I used to care about people in my family. I couldn't believe I couldn't figure out why my family would do these things to each other, you know, or to me. And because I loved my family when I was a little kid. And then as I grew older, like an older teen, well, actually maybe a mid-teen, somewhere around, you know, 13, 14, just after so many years of abuse, physical abuse, emotional abuse, psychological, verbal, sexual abuse, I just shut down and started to hate myself. I actually felt dead at the age of 10. I say it really started at 8 with the sexual abuse, but by 10 years old, I really felt dead because my mom had beaten me severely and broke my nose. And I just really felt that she had killed me. And then she came and beat me again with a belt. It was just a horrible situation one particular day for me. And I felt dead. And I told her, I'm dead. You may as well just kill me. And from then on, I was dead. I was just a walking. I really felt dead. And I felt that I was just this walking shell and that I was not really there. My spirit was dead. I really felt dead. And so a few years later, the age of 15, I actually cursed God in the backyard because my best friend was hit by a car. And I couldn't believe that he would allow that to happen when I was the one that wanted to be dead. And I was like, you should have took me, not her. I'm the one that wanted to go. So I'm in the backyard cursing God because he wasn't there. He wasn't there for me when I was being raped. He wasn't there for me when my parents were beating on me, you know. And you know, he wasn't there for when my brothers were overdosing or doing crime. You know, there was a lot of crime going on in our family with my brothers. They were all on drugs. It was a terrible situation. And I thought, where was God? You know, so I had a lot of problems with God and a lot of problems with self-worth. I had problems with it all. and love, you know, I didn't really receive love as a child, so I didn't really understand it. And I didn't, I knew that I wanted it, but I didn't know how to let someone love me because I didn't really know how to properly love somebody, right? And so it was just this issue of, I had a whole lot of problems to deal with, you know, when I came to the Lord. And so as far as self-worth goes, you know, man, in our fallen state, you know, we're never going to be able to properly see ourselves the way that God sees us in Christ, because God no longer sees us in our sin nature. After we're born again, you know, we are a new creation, a new creature unto God. And it's only by Jesus' righteousness. It's none of our own. And so we are covered by him. We're covered by his righteousness. That's why God sees us, you know, back in right standing with him, because he sees his son. He doesn't see us. He sees his son. We're covered by his blood. We're like the redeemed ones. Hallelujah. Praise God. And so, you know, it's a beautiful thing when you think of it that way. So after I was born again, I started to realize, like, wow, God loved me enough to send his son to die on the cross for me, for my sin. And that, you know, and I cried and cried for, like, I don't know, quite a few weeks after I was born again, because I could feel God pushing out the hatred in my heart for what had happened to me as a child and my family, really. It wasn't just about the abuse. I mean, I was just really miserable about what had happened to our family. It was just destroyed. And I was like, I could feel this hatred being pushed out and love coming in for the first time in my life. Real love. The love of God. And I could feel it. And I was like, oh, wow, this is just amazing. And I cried and cried. And I just felt like he was comforting me. He was there. He was holding me. I felt surrounded. I just lay on the couch. I was actually off in between jobs. I wasn't working. And I just lay on the couch and just cried. I was by myself, actually. My husband actually and I had separated for 5 years because he's terminally ill, and he's still around, but he went into a home, but he's like a senior's place, like that had a nurse on site, but we're back together, but praise God, and he's still alive because God keeps sustaining him, praise the Lord. But anyway, you know, I was by myself, and I had 3 weeks, you know, and I just cried and cried and cried and allowed all that to come out, and I thought, you know, what a great gift I had been given. You know, because, yeah, I didn't feel like I was worthy of God's love. I didn't feel like I was worthy of anything. You know, I cursed God in the backyard and, you know, out loud, screaming in the backyard. Neighbors heard, my mom heard. It was a terrible situation, you know. You know, I couldn't figure out how could he love me, you know. And where was he? And then I realized he was there the whole time. And that he was crying. I could just see it in my mind's eye. I mean, I don't believe that God literally cried tears. What the issue is I believe that he was grieved. He doesn't want mankind to be doing these horrible things to each other. But he knows that until things are made right, this is what's going to happen. And so, you know, I really felt like I was being healed and comforted, you know, when I first was born again, May 22nd, 2007. Really, I could feel the change from hatred to love in my heart. So as the years progressed, I got into the Bible. I started reading it 72 hours a week, literally. I mean, I'd read the Bible on my lunch breaks while I was walking. I would be reading the Bible all the time. And I would read, I logged my hours reading the Bible, and I would read it 72 hours a week. And I did that for the first couple of years, just round and round and round the whole Bible, start to finish. And plus Bible studies, like just really soaking up the word, praise God. And didn't do any reflection or looking back or thinking about my own situation or where it had just come from. Because May 22nd, 2007, the reason that date's important is because a month before that, I was actually considering committing suicide because I was at the lowest point that I really had probably ever been as an adult. You know, in my teen years, I had hit pretty low, pretty rock bottom, but as an adult, I was 42 years old, 41 and a half, and hit rock bottom as far as my emotions went. I couldn't deal with the pain anymore, and I had always had suicidal ideation my whole life. I didn't want to be around. Two of my brothers committed suicide, and my dad was also suicidal, but he never made it, but he lived on to be 94 years old. But he was suicidal, and he used to try to get himself killed. He'd try to several different ways. I mean, he would just do all kinds of crazy things. But my brothers actually did make it. They killed themselves, two of my older brothers. One of them being the brother that sexually abused me, and the other one a brother who was 7 years older than me. And, you know, so I knew what suicide was, and I didn't necessarily want to kill myself. I just had suicidal ideation because I was just in so much pain. I didn't know how to get out of that pain. And, you know, I used drugs until the age of 21 to try to get out of that pain, 12 to 21. And that didn't help. And I got off the drugs, straightened my life up that way at the age of 21, and did really well through till 42 with no alcohol, no drugs. Just cigarettes, really. That's my main bad thing, coffee and cigarettes. But otherwise, you know, I was drug-free as far as that went. And, you know, I couldn't find anything. I couldn't find it. I couldn't find any happiness. I couldn't find any peace. I couldn't find any reason to really want to live. At the age of 42, I just hit such rock bottom. And I just felt, you know, this one voice, this one side of me was saying, yeah, go ahead and kill yourself. You're just worthless. You're just useless. Your parents hated your guts. You know, I could feel the beatings and the horrific stuff that used to happen to me, you know, the body memories and stuff. I had severe issues with PTSD. And, you know, I was just sitting there thinking, yeah, I'm just useless, worthless. You know, nobody really loves me. Nobody cares about me. What's the use, you know? And on the other side of my shoulder was this other voice, which these were not audible voices. This was just my feelings of how the whole thing was happening. On this one side was the other side telling me, no, you got to live. Live. And this other side would say, no, go ahead and kill yourself. Just rip yourself to shreds. Show the world your pain and what happened to you. And then the other side said, you know, then me, I'd come in and say, nobody cares. Nobody's going to care if I kill myself. Yeah, that's what woke me up. That's exactly what woke me up. I realized that nobody would care if I actually ended my life. So I realized that's why I was doing it. I was like, yeah, nobody's going to care if I kill myself or rip myself to shreds. Nobody's going to care. Nobody's going to come to my funeral. Nobody's going to even know. They won't even care. So why am I doing this? You know, what's this for? I'm just going to hurt myself more than I've already been wounded in my lifetime. Why would I want to do that? And I thought, and this one side was saying, live. You have to live, right? And I realized that was God, because God is life. I do that. The devil was saying, no, I'll kill yourself. You're just worthless anyway. You know? And I was like, oh my, I've been, you know, this is ridiculous. I was like, okay, I made a deal with God, even though God doesn't make deals. I made a deal with him. And I said, you know what? I will never again ever do that. But I mean, I went a little bit deeper than that. But I mean, I told him, no, that's it. That's the last time ever. I'm going to live. I'm going to live and I'm going to do what I'm going to do. I'm going to just do it. And I'm going to get serious about this. This is ridiculous. I realized at that point that God was the one the whole time that was telling me to live. Even through those years of wandering around North America, not even realizing that he was telling me to live. And to keep going. I had people in my life, special people in my life, not part of my family, who came along through the years, different people, even when I was younger, you know, 12 years old, 14 years old, and up, who would tell me the nicest things. They'd be like, you know, you've got to learn how to love yourself. You got to learn how to, you need to learn how to love and not hate, right? Because they would kind of know about my situation, where I came from. And I was like, and I thought that was nice of them to say that, but I was just like, well, that's fine, you know. But it never really seemed to help, you know. And then I realized all these people, I mean, really, that was God's voice coming through. You've got to live. You've got to love. You need to have love in your heart, you know. And all this stuff started coming to me. And I was like, wow, that was God the whole time, working through people to try to say the right things to me at the right time that really I didn't think made a difference at that time. But then eventually I realized that was the difference. That made all the difference. Because at the age of 42, I remembered and I was like, oh, wow, you know, praise God. A month later, I was born again. And I mean, hallelujah. I came out of the pits of hell to God saying, live, live. I am life. You know, I'm the true vine. I'm the way, praise God. Jesus Christ. The truth, the life, and the way. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so I was born again, and I tell you, I've been a Jesus freak ever since. I mean, I love the Old Testament, and I love the New Testament equally. And I read them both all the time. And I mean, I just love the Word of God. And it's just, he's saved me in so many ways, I can't even describe. I can't even begin to go into detail. It would take too long. But he saved me really out of the pits of hell that I was in. And he saved me from my own premature death, taking my life. He saved me eternally to live with him for eternity. Praise God. I mean, I know where I'm going when I leave this earth suit. I'm going to be with the Lord. And that brings me some peace and some joy. And so as far as self-worth goes, you know, I started to see myself the way that God saw me. That he didn't want those terrible things to happen to me. And that he wanted me to live and to experience life in Christ. Hallelujah. Because when I was 18 years old, I had a car accident. And you want to listen to the song I was listening to when I had this car accident with my friends in the car. And it was a really bad car accident. I almost died, actually. It was a song called I Won't Be Born Again by Black Sabbath. Okay, I was singing that song while we were just before we wrecked. And I don't know if you know the song, but it's just from the old days, from my heavy metal days when I was 18. And, you know, I was singing that song before with my friends before I wrecked that car. And then, you know, to me, I look back on it and I'm like, God gave me another chance. You know, he gave me another chance to be born again. And he said, you will be born again. He's like, listen to me. Live. You know, so May 22nd, 2007, I gave my life to serve the Lord. Hallelujah. And I mean, I've been, and I'm just holding on with everything I have. And I can't do it in my own strength. It's got to be him, and he's doing it. Praise God. So, you know, my feelings of, as far as my self-worth went, I started to realize that, yeah, okay, my parents didn't really do the right things by me. It's a fallen world. It's a horrible situation. I need to forgive them. It was a hard job I had to do. I had to go through and do the forgiveness work. I had to go through and do the healing work on all this stuff. I couldn't just let it go. I spent years on this. That's why I have all this one child abuse survivor stuff. I've done like 1,000 audios, you know, I don't know how many videos. I mean, just doing a whole lot of work on this. And I do my own studies on this and do the shows because I hope that they'll help somebody. But, you know, I had to go through. I couldn't just let it go for some reason. You know, I probably could have if I wanted to, but I didn't. And so it's taken me now, you know, from 2000, basically 2010 or 2009, I guess I say, I started my real work on the, working on forgiveness issues, self-hatred, self-worth and whatnot. And all of these things that, you know, this baggage that I picked up from this abuse that I suffered so long ago, and then dragged into my adult life myself, I have had to learn how to deal with it. And so it's taken a long time. I couldn't just wander past it. I was hoping that I could, but it didn't work out that way. So, you know, it's been a long road. It's been a long, hard road of really looking at the situations and looking at myself and saying, you know, I mean, this is, you have to forgive. It says right in the Bible there, you know, I mean, who can forgive sins? Only God can forgive sin. But I'm not forgiving the sin. I'm forgiving the person. It's not the sin I'm forgiving. Only God can forgive sin. And that's only through the cross of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And so, you know, I have to do the work here to allow God to change my heart and to change my mind. And to change, just like all these preachers are preaching about on the TV. You know, if you're into the TV ministries, you know what I mean? They're all preaching, you know, change your heart, change your mind. Well, they're actually true. They're true on the theology of it. And it's true because we are, like the Apostle Paul said, I love the Apostle Paul's writings. You know, put on the mind of Christ. You know, that old Lori died on the cross. So I am to that old sin nature, that old glory. I mean, she's gone. I'm a new creature, a new creation in Christ. Hallelujah. And so I need to put on Christ and try to align my thinking with the Bible, not to try to align the Bible with my thinking. So it would just be another maligned situation. I need to align my thinking with the Bible. And so, you know, yeah, so as far as self-worth goes, yeah, I know I'm no longer that person that I used to be, because I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. And so my old, that old Lori, she's gone. But the thing is, I mean, I still had to deal with my memories and from my past. And so, yeah, my family didn't really love me or do the right things by me. And that's too bad. That's sad. And I realized for years it bothered me. And I thought about it and I thought, you know what? It doesn't matter that if they love me or not. Because I know there's one that did. That's God. And he loved me enough to send it, you know, to send his son to die on the cross for me. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God loves me. That's all that matters. Because he's my eternal creator. He's my eternal creator, my maker. And so my parents didn't love me. Okay. I forgive them. You know? I mean, it wasn't just the issue of love. I mean, they created a lot of problems for me. My brother hurt me, sexually abused me. I'm barren. I can't have children because of the sexual abuse. You know, nothing's, there's no, never going to be any restitution, right? But it's been the hardest thing, but I've had to forgive him. He's dead. He died. He committed suicide at the age of 33 when I was 20, just before I could have, would have probably pressed charges when I went to a gynecologist. He died at the age of 33 from suicide. So the year before I actually went for my gynecology checkup, my first one, which I didn't, you know, I won't go into details here, but I didn't know that I was barren at the time and found out that I was barren because of the child sexual abuse. So no possibility of children. So, you know, that changed my life, you know. And I mean, you know, I said, I mean, yeah, okay. He sinned against me, but first he sinned against God. That's all the sins that were committed against me. They were first sins against God, and then it was a sin against me. And that's the same with my sin that I've sinned. You know, we're all sinners, every single one of us. We can try to be the nicest person on the planet, but you're still a sinner. You're still going to hurt somebody somewhere. And I mean, you know, I've had to think about the things that I've done in the past, and it's like I want forgiveness, you know? And I can't speak to these people because they're gone or I don't know where they are, you know, and I would want them to forgive me. Not that I deserve it, but I would just ask for their mercy. And that's just, you know, the same issue with God. But God is ever, he's got everlasting mercy. Praise God. He is a God of his. He is mercy. Praise the Lord. So yeah, these issues, you know, they're pretty tough. But I know as far as that went, as soon as I started to realize that God loved me, that changed everything. Because I was like, oh, this is awesome. I'm going to go. This eternity is a long time. This earth life is very short. It seems long sometimes, but it's very short. And you know, as far as eternity goes, I mean, it's going to be a long, long, long eternal life in the most beautiful, pleasant, precious, glorious, almighty situation a person can even, we can't even imagine it properly, right? We're going to be just worshiping God and being and doing God's work, whatever He wants us to do for eternity. Hallelujah. Praise God. We'll have the mind of Christ. We won't have any corruption. Our bodies won't be any, there won't be any corruption at that point. No corruption of the mind, no corruption of the body, no corruption anywhere. It'll just be true, glorious, heavenly, awesome eternity. I'm all for it. Praise God. And I'm looking for it, forward to it. And I just, you know, as long as the Lord wants me here on the earth, that's fine. But I'm waiting for it. I believe in the rapture and I'm waiting. I'm looking for him. And just like the Apostle Paul said, there's a crown for those who love his appearing. And so I'll get a crown of some sort. I don't think I'll get very many because I don't deserve very many. But I'm definitely looking for his appearing and I love his appearing. So I'll get one of those crowns. I hope I don't lose it somewhere in there. But yeah, these issues, these are tough, you know. You know, as far as this, that, then we can just turn from that and we can say, you know, as far as self-worth and self-acceptance goes, you know, self-acceptance, like if God sent his son to die on the cross for me and I accept that sacrifice and he accepts that sacrifice and I'm brought back into right standing because of that, born again. I need to accept myself as God would accept me, you know, and no one's perfect. And I have days where, you know, I don't feel the most confident. And I think this is true for a lot of people, you know, a lot of people have days and times in their life when, you know, something goes wrong or something just doesn't go right. things don't happen the way they should, the way we think they should. And possibly maybe we didn't get the promotion that we wanted. I mean, I'm just talking to just generally anybody out there. This has happened to me several times, and I didn't get the promotion that I wanted. You know, or maybe I wasn't right for the role. That's always a problem for me working, because, you know, I try so hard to be able to do it, because it's not only trying to prove to somebody else, but just trying to prove to myself that I can do it. So I do take on challenges quite often, and sometimes I get turned down for them, you know, and it's always heartbreaking, because I'm thinking, I could do this. But then it just wasn't meant to be. It doesn't necessarily reflect on me, right? But I tend to take it personally because of the way that it was brought up and the way that I felt about myself, right? As far as self-acceptance goes, I mean, we are responsible for our actions, you know? And as far as whether or not I can accept myself, you know, I spent years not accepting myself. That's the issue. And after I was born again and started really working on my healing journey, it's these two, actually there were three books that were very, very helpful. John Bradshaw's work. John Bradshaw, he wrote books really geared for adult survivors of child abuse, but they're very helpful for people who have suffered kind of any kind of traumatic stuff in childhood, right? And so there's lots of neat questions in there that kind of make you think, right? You do the homework. And I like those two books that he put out. One is called Homecoming, Healing the Wounded Inner Child, or Healing the Wounded Child Within, or something. And then the other one is Healing the Shame That Binds You. Really, really good stuff. I really learned a lot from those books. And also Robert Burney, Codependence, The Dance of Wounded Souls. That was very, very good. And I have all three of those books. And I used them, I read them, I did the homework in them. It was very, very helpful. Because it showed me, I didn't even know really what to think about a lot of my own problems, because I didn't do any counseling or any therapy or anything. And so I didn't know what a lot of my problems were until I read those books, and I realized, oh, that's what I do. Oh, this is why I do that. Oh, okay. And it was very, very helpful. And so as far as self-acceptance goes, you know, I had to learn how to accept myself. I have to learn how to accept myself as God sees me, you know, because before I was just in so much having so many problems with my own abilities, my own capabilities, right? Oh, I'm just this abuse kid, you know. Even though I never thought of myself as a child who grew up abused, I was just being abused. I just thought of myself as this tough kind of girl who did drugs and really, you know, I tried in life to make things kind of work and tried to do things in life that just never really worked out. And, you know, couldn't find love. You know, I didn't trust people, never trusted anybody, didn't trust my own decision-making processes, but I really didn't trust anybody else's, that's for sure. A lot of problems, just with so many different things. And, you know, if issues of self-sabotage, because I felt like, you know, since there's these issues where, you know, I'm just kind of worthless and useless and people just dump me eventually anyway out of their life, then I'll dump them first. And that way I don't have to be hurt, right? So I end friendships, I end working relationships, I just tend to end things and leave and quit, because it's easier for me that way than to take the more pain of being accepted for a little while and then not being accepted. So that's sort of my issues. But as far as self-acceptance goes, you know, I've worked on it through the years to realize, like, especially after being born again, before that doesn't really matter, because that's the old stuff. Now working with what I know from the Word of God, you know, self-acceptance, like, I'm never going to be good enough. I'm never going to live up to God's standards. That's just not even possible. So I don't even, to be honest with you, I don't really try to be a 100% be-all, you know, Christian. Obviously, you can tell by the way I'm talking here, to try to impress somebody or to try to make myself seem like I'm so holy, or I'm so much better than so-and-so, and I just know so much more about the Bible than so-and-so, and oh, look at me. You know, the issue is I'm just learning, and I just love the Lord, and I ask the Lord to use me whenever he wants. You know, I'm just a vessel for his use, and some days I feel like I'm not doing anything for him, you know, but I can't do it in my own strength. I can't do it in my own capabilities. It has to come from the Lord. Nothing we can do in the flesh pleases God. And so, you know, I mean, yeah, I just, you know, I feel like I've let him down. And, you know, but I know that he still accepts me. So I have trust. And I think what God has done is it's the most amazing transformation, because to be honest with you, that's really where that comes from. That's self-acceptance. You know, I trust God that, you know, so much that if I end up in the gutter, a homeless person with no teeth at the age of 75, 80, and nothing but the clothes on my back, I'm just going to keep worshiping God, and I'm just going to keep trusting God, because he's taking me where he wants me to go. He's taking me on this path. I don't know where it's going. I don't know where he wants me to end up, you know, but I trust him, and I know that I'm in his hands, and that the path is before me. He's laid it out. I'm walking in it. It's a heart issue. It really has very little to do with what's going on around us in this existence that we're in. It's a heart issue. And he called Abraham, you know, he called Abraham out, and he's like, Abraham, you know, you got to leave your country and go to a land I will show you, or I'll give you. And he made promises to him, and he cut the covenant with him. And, you know, Abraham had to completely go by faith, by trust, you know. And so, you know, I think that as far as self-acceptance goes, I trust that, you know, that covenant relationship that's, you know, that he has with me through Christ, you know, because, I mean, I don't know if it's because of covenant, so much a covenant relationship, but by the blood of Christ, you know, and by the cross, you know, by the resurrection, you know, I've been redeemed. I've been renewed, a new creature unto God. So he doesn't see me in my old sin nature. He sees me just as his son. I'm a child. I'm a joint heir with Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. And so what I try to do is remember that while I'm here, and try to walk in that, because I realize, like, wow, you know, I'm no longer supposed to be doing the same things I was doing before, or thinking the same way that I was thinking before. I'm supposed to be thinking as Christ would think, you know. And do I do it all the time? No, you know, I can't throughout the day, you know, I mean, certain days I do better than others. It's still really not that good. And I think there's a lot of people out there fooling themselves, especially a lot of pastors, famous pastors on TV, or certain ones that you hear of. They seem to think they're just really so high holy, you know, and, oh, I'm so good, look at me, I've just made it, you know. And it's like, you know, okay, buddy, we don't know what your thoughts were, you know, 2 hours ago before you actually showed up to the service. You know what I mean? Like, only God knows, right? God knows our hearts. God knows what's going on in our hearts. Come on. And so, you know, yeah, we have to accept ourselves as God sees us. So God sees me in my redeemed, you know, brought back into right standing with him, position because of his son, because of Christ Jesus and what he did for us. And so I see myself as that. That's how I see myself. I don't see myself any higher or any lower than that. And I just know that I'm still in this flesh body, stuck in this earth, you know, with a lot of problems still going on all around me. And how am I going to react? Am I going to react with the mind of Christ, or am I going to react in my old sin way, my old sin nature, you know? Am I going to be hurtful, hateful? Or am I just going to choose to allow God to move and to speak through me to certain situations or, you know, whatever the situation may be, right? To be used by God, hallelujah, for his purposes, praise God. And so, you know, there's just so much that could be said to all of this. I'm just kind of going off the cuff because I have to do this briefly. And really part of the reason I wanted to do this tonight is because I'm moving. I'm in the process of moving. My husband and I have to move. And we've been in this place 10 years, and I'm packing and cleaning. It's a lot of work. He's terminally ill, and so he can't really help. And I work full-time as well, and I'm really overtaxed, overbusy. And in the next 4 weeks or so, I'm not going to have time to do anything like this. And so I thought I'd do it tonight because I'm going to run out of time. And I thought I better do it tonight because eventually, especially the next 2 or 3 weeks, I think this is going to be really hectic. And because I work full time, I'm not going to have any time off. I have to pack, clean, move us, orchestrate this whole entire thing. We have no vehicle, you know, and I got no friends to help move. And so, you know, this is all God. God's going to have to make this happen. Right? And so I thought I better do this now. So that's why I'm doing it. But yeah, I didn't want to plan this out and write this out. And, you know, I'm speaking from my heart, right? And, you know, as far as a person might think, well, you know, I just don't feel like I'm saved, or I don't feel like I'm, like, I feel like I might be going to hell. I mean, I have seen that several times in my lifetime. My dad was one who believed that. My dad was a born-again Christian. He just recently passed away. And he loved God. He loved Jesus. I know he did. And he studied the Bible for years, years and years and years. But he had such a guilt complex, you know. And I don't know if it was had to do with the abuse or what, but he never really took responsibility for the abuse. So I don't think that was it. I think he just felt that he was just so low down, and how could God truly save him? And, you know, he was just not good enough. And he was, I think what that is, it's just a lack of trust. You know, God said, you know, believe, you will be saved. You know, a person born again, you have to know you're saved. I mean, the minute you're born again, they say there's no such thing as eternal security. There's a lot of people that speak to that. But the issue is there's no possible way, unless you reject Christ, that you can be ripped out of the Father's hands. There's no sin you can commit. We have to confess our sin. We have to get back into right standing with God when we sin. You know, when I sin, I have to repent and I have to confess it, and I shouldn't feel bad about it. I mean, I should feel like there's something wrong with that. You know, it's like I go and I do something terrible, you know, to somebody, or say something terrible, or do something, you know, something that I shouldn't be doing, that I know is a sin against God, or a sin against another person. First, it's a sin against God. I need to repent, you know, and I have to do this all the time. And I do repent, and I'm like, Lord, forgive me, you know. I mean, I know better than that. It's got to be a heart change, you know. And so I'm like just letting the Lord work with me, you know, and the Holy Spirit, praise God. And I know that Jesus is my advocate. You know, he's our high priest, right? He's there, you know, making intercession for us, right? We're not going to hell. Right? A person born again is not going to hell, right? If you've been born again and you trusted Christ and you understand the issue of salvation and what does it for you, that's Jesus Christ, hallelujah, and you get the whole thing, and you actually give your life to him. You say, Lord, you know, it's no longer my life, it's yours. You know, I died with you on the cross. I've been resurrected with you in newness of life. You know, I believe. You are saved. The Holy Spirit seals you. You're saved for eternity. I think the only possible way a person could actually fall from grace, really, there's that whole issue of falling from grace. That's not, has nothing to do with eternal salvation. The issue is that once saved, always saved. That's just the way it is. Unless you just turn around and completely reject Christ. And just, I think that's a real problem. If somebody just denounces the whole thing and starts worshiping and serving another God, well, God knows who are his, right? So that's where that comes in. He knows who are his. And he knows your heart. And if you love God and you truly know what was done on the cross, born again, you're saved. That's all there is to it. There's too many scriptures that speak to that. And some of the stuff that people try to use to not speak to that is not cohesive with the rest of the Bible. So it doesn't make any sense. We can't pull one scripture out here and one scripture out there. And you have to kind of, people have to know what the context was when they're speaking to some of those other passages that they say, oh, there's no such thing as eternal security. You know, that a person could fall from grace. And it's like, no, you have to be very careful with the scriptures. That's why I study Hebrew and Greek, the original languages, because you have to know what context, what they were talking about, and why they were talking about it in the Bible in order to get the whole picture, right? So it's very important. So, yeah, no, once saved, always saved. That's all there is to it. So, yeah, my dad, he did terrible things. He was born again Christian. He thought he was going to hell. He loved God, truly loved Jesus, abused his wife, abused his children, that includes me. He was an abusive man, but then, you know, he was a good guy to other people. He was a nice guy to other people. It's not like he went around abusing other people or hurting other people. It was just his family, right? And he loved God. And do I think that he went to heaven? Absolutely. You know, he never rejected God. He rejected himself. He really felt bad about himself. He never really had any self-worth. That's why I think he was always kind of suicidal. My dad was abused as a child. And so my mother was too. Both my parents were abused. And they just continued the abuse on to us, right? And so it was just a horrific cycle. So, you know, I've I knew where he came from, you know, and I mean, I knew what kind of situation he came from. And so, you know, it's like I could see his problems, you know what I mean? And I knew he didn't necessarily feel bad about what he did to his wife, because he never ever did feel bad about that. And he never said that he felt bad about that. But that's between him and God, you know. He's gonna have to deal with that. So yeah, he might lose some rewards and sort of thing, but I don't believe he's going to hell because of that. No. You know, once he's saved, he's saved, you know. Because he probably confessed that sin to God. It's just he would never admit it to anybody else. That's the problem. But he doesn't have to confess it to me. You know, as long as we confess our sins to God, he is faithful to cleanse us, you know, from all sin. Praise God. And just like the scripture said. So, you know, it's important to know that, you know. And I don't know. I just think that it's real easy to get down on ourselves, you know, and to feel like, well, I don't feel the, like maybe other Christians might be feeling. I don't feel the love. I don't feel the joy. I don't feel the, you know, like maybe I should be feeling as a Christian. I see, you know, because there are some Christians who just are bubbly and they just seem to be overflowing and sort of that type, right? And, you know, that's actually, I think, a personality type. I think it doesn't have much to do with anything else, because I'm not a bubbly, overflowing, joyful Christian. I'm just kind of a matter-of-fact person. You know, I grew up tough, and I'm a tough girl, and, you know, I'm not a real, you know, bubbly type person. And I don't run around going, oh, joy, joy. But I have, what I've got is what a lot of people don't have, and that's real joy. Because it's not the type of joy that's just superficial, where I'm joyful for 5 minutes and then I'm not joyful. I'm actually joyful 24/7. I'm joyful all the time. And it doesn't mean that I'm jumping around and running in circles and I'm so happy. And that probably has a lot to do with the way I grew up. I mean, I was abused as a child, right? You know, I mean, I've suffered in my lifetime severely. And it's just like so many other people, right? And not only that, my husband's terminally ill. He's been sick. He's been terminally ill for 15 years, 16 years now. And they gave him 2 to 5 years to live. And he's still here by the grace of God. By the grace of God. Hallelujah. Well, that brings me some joy. I don't want my husband to suffer. He's suffering. He's been suffering quite a lot for the last 7 years or so. I don't want him to suffer. But in the meantime, he still has some good days. But we don't run around and jump around in joy, joy, and all happiness and everything. But we also don't sit around and mope either. We just live our lives as we did before, and we just keep going. We've been together 22 years, and we met when I was 30. So at the age of 42 is when I had that breakdown. So, I mean, we've been together a long time. And, you know, we had no children together. Obviously, I'm barren, right? We never had any children. But he was diagnosed 6 years into the relationship, terminally ill, right? But I found true love. And then when I met the Lord, I realized that God had brought me and him together. I know that he did. And this man has been so good to me. And he is a good man. He's a very decent man. He's a good man. And God allowed me to have real, to know what that real love is like. You know, that what it should be like between a man and a woman. And I believe God has given me so many things. He's given me everything. And he just keeps sustaining me. These are the things that I'm joyful about, you know. And it's not these little things like, It's not like some people just get really excited and bubbling over and very joyful about certain things. And I'm really not that type. I think it's more of a personality thing. But I think it's better just to have that joy all the time. And even if it doesn't necessarily show on our face or show on our body somewhere that we're dancing around or laughing and giggling about something being joyful, I have that joy down in my heart, and it's always there. You know, even when I'm sorrowing, I'm joyful, right? Because I know that it's just very temporary, and it's very temporal. It's just a temporal thing, and I'm looking forward to my eternal, wonderful eternity with God. Hallelujah. And the joy that's really going to be, that's going to be very, very much joyful. So that's very exciting. That gives me a lot of joy. As far as love and stuff goes, I mean, God, God is love, and God surely has shown me love, showed me how to love and how to receive love and how to give love. He showed me real love because he showed me his love, because man's love is very superficial compared to God's love. God's love is real because God is love, right?